Throughout the course of human history, many of the greatest human civilizations have explained the origins of the Earth in mythological terms. One typical creation myth is still told in Asia today. It tells of the goddess Izanami and her brother Izanagi, and how they dipped a sword into the ocean. When droplets of water fell from the blade, they formed a group of islands to the east of the Asian continent. Islands that would become home to a remarkable and enduring civilization, Japan.
Aspects of Japanese civilization which are most appreciated and most admired today may not be the same that people will admire Japan for in 100 years' time, and are not what people admired Japan for 100 years ago. For example, 100 years ago, people thought of Japanese civilization as incredibly belligerent, incredibly fierce and strong. Nowadays, we don't think of Japan that way. Japanese people certainly don't think of Japan that way. We're much more likely to talk about Zen and Japanese minimalism, the cult of non-flamboyance, the cult of peace, and the Japanese term for this is harmony.
We all know, for instance, that the Japanese are associated with very delicate gardens. And that love of nature is shown, I think, not only in paintings and statues and woodblocks and other aspects of artistry which have come down to us in the current day, but are visible throughout the whole of the last 1,000 years, influenced perhaps by Buddhism, which has been such a strong part of the Japanese cultural tradition, as well as its own native religion of Shinto.
According to Japanese legend, the creator god, Izanagi, also created the moon goddess and the sun goddess. The grandson, Ninigi, then came down to Earth, to the island of Kyushu. Finally, in the year 660 BC, Ninigi's grandson, Jimmu, became the first emperor of a people who soon spread from Kyushu to the Yamato plain of central Honshu. Although this is the stuff of legends, it does contain a grain of truth. By 100 BC, a young nation was establishing itself on the Yamato plain. They were people of Asian origin who had arrived from the continental mainland some centuries before.
What seems to have happened is that one group of peoples came across from the Korean continent in large numbers, and that would probably have been in the early decades or early centuries of the Christian era. And they met with a Siberian people already there, who are now known as the Ainu. And at some point, also probably before the arrival of the people from the continent, there were South Sea Island people of one kind or another. There are, for example, Japanese words and also aspects of early Japanese architecture and funeral practice and things which are very much related to Polynesian ways of behaving. Otherwise, of course, there's always been a huge influence from the continent. The continental influence tended to kind of obliterate much of what happened, what was known before. It was only with the arrival of the continental peoples that there's a writing system in Japan. So we can only speculate on what happened before.
This is one of the hot areas, I guess, of archaeology, is trying to get the links with the mainland or the southern routes. But it's very hard to say definitively, I think, yet exactly. There isn't a single source, it's rather a mixed source, with layers of migration at different times.
The first historical record of Japan is found in a Chinese document dated 57 AD. It describes a visit to China from a diplomatic envoy from the islands in the east. Over the following centuries, links between the two countries developed. It was the Chinese who called Japan the land of the rising sun, or Ruburn, a name which, over time, evolved into Japan. Trade and commercial contact increased, and with it, the flow of cultural ideas. By the 6th century AD, a major Chinese religion had arrived on Japan's shores. The Japanese people already had a spiritual identity. They practiced an informal, cult-like worship of a huge number of divinities. The sun goddess was just one of these. In the 6th century, this local belief system became known as Shinto, meaning the way of the gods. This was to distinguish it from the new Chinese faith, Buddhism. Buddhism would never eliminate the old beliefs completely, but did become a central feature of Japanese life.
In the 6th century AD, Buddhism became very popular in the Japanese court. The emperor and also those at court thought that this was an exciting and potentially very influential new way to think about religion. And their enthusiasm was then spread down from the official level down to the people.
The powers that be probably saw through experience, and some of them of course had been migrants from the mainland, either from Korean world or from China, that Buddhism came with Chinese civilization, with the writing system, with the system of government, and the use of temples as learning centers and civilizing centers, as it were.
There's a Chinese-style monarchy comes into existence, Chinese laws, Japan builds a capital city to look like a Chinese city. Now, China at that stage had the role that perhaps the USA has today or that Britain had in the 19th century. It defines the way a country which sees itself as advanced and sophisticated has to be. And that's what Japan got from embracing Buddhism. After Buddhism arrives, it becomes amalgamated with Shinto, almost completely amalgamated with Shinto, so that there is no distinction, really, between Buddhism and Shinto. They are kind of different aspects of each other.
Within decades of the arrival of Buddhism, temples were being constructed in the Yamato heartland. In 607 AD, to the southwest of Nara, a Japanese prince founded the temple complex of Hōyū-ji. In the early 620s, this kondo, or great hall, was added to the Hōyū-ji site, and the first masterpiece of Japanese architecture was completed. Like all Japanese buildings at the time, the kondo was made of wood. The Japanese islands were heavily forested, and the use of brick was virtually unknown until modern times. Inevitably, many of these wooden buildings have failed to survive, but the kondo has managed to remain fully intact for 14 centuries.
The Hōryū-ji is the oldest surviving wooden building. There is nothing else anywhere in the world from so early in the 8th century, a freestanding wooden building. So it's spectacular simply on account of its antiquity and its state of preservation. But it's been able to survive because it was regarded right from its foundation as a very important structure.
The kondo reveals the influence of Chinese design. It's a two-story building of post and beam construction, topped with an elegantly curved ceramic tile roof, hipped and gabled in the style known as irimoya. Inside, a wooden paneled hall containing a priceless collection of bronze statues, including the so-called Shaka Trinity, a sculpture of the Buddha flanked by two of his saints. Around the time that the kondo hall was built, Buddhism was becoming the dominant feature of Japanese spiritual life. Soon, the new faith also began to influence secular affairs. Japan was now an established empire, but it still had no permanent capital. According to Shinto belief, when an emperor died, his successor had to find a new location to rule from. With the rise of Buddhism, this tradition was abandoned. In the year 710, the Japanese emperor established a permanent capital at Nara. By the end of the century, it had moved to Haira, now known as Kyoto. It would remain there for almost 11 centuries. But the emperor himself would enjoy little in the way of political power. Throughout Japanese history, It has been powerful families or clans who have filled the positions of real authority. In the 9th century, the Fujiwara clan became the effective rulers, and the emperors gradually withdrew from political life. This division between the nominal head of state and the real source of power became established. A striking contrast to the situation in Europe, where the king was very much the dominant figure.
The imperial rule was maintained by cultural capital, not through power or through wealth. It was the job of the emperor and of his court to maintain the cultural tradition. And so it was generally seen as the role of the holders of real political power to sponsor the imperial family, to maintain their lifestyle, to ensure that the ancient rituals were upheld, that the ceremonies were done in due season.
It's a way that the particular government legitimizes its power by supporting the emperor, by interlinking through marriage with the imperial household, and through that then it gains, in other words, rather than just the power of the sword or the gun, but the sense of legitimacy by association with the center.
To that extent, the emperor's life was in one sense quite a luxurious one, but also a rather frustrating one, kept inside the palace with various entertainments, but not allowed to carry out any affairs of state or exercise real power.
The rule of the Fujiwara lasted until the mid-12th century. Many Japanese consider this to have been a golden age. Contacts with China faded as Japan developed its own national identity. But ideas from the mainland were still influential. New strains of Chinese Buddhism arrived. The Shingon sect proved especially popular. And in the middle of the 10th century, the Shingon temple complex of Daigo-chi was constructed at the foot of Daigo. Its most distinctive feature, a wooden structure that has survived to this day, a wonderful example of the most distinctive of Buddhist temple buildings, the pagoda.
A pagoda is based on an original type of Indian architectural feature called a stupa, and its original purpose was to keep relics of the Buddha, perhaps some remnants of the man himself, or else keeping scriptures which had been produced by Buddhist clerics. That was adapted when Buddhism spread into China and Japan to use these adapted versions of stupas, which became known as pagodas, for holding Buddhist masses or other religious ceremonies. Chinese and Japanese pagodas are actually quite distinctive because their shape involves a certain number of towers, which if you check will almost always be an odd number. And in fact, most of those surviving today, in fact all except one in Japan, are either 3 or 5 stories high.
The reason for odd numbers is not entirely clear, but possibly it's intended to suggest that perfection has not been reached, that the pagoda soars upwards. And if you have an odd number, you have a kind of notional sense of a continuity ever upwards.
The popularity of the Shingon strain of Buddhism led to the construction of many wonderful pagoda buildings. But the Daigo-chi remains the greatest surviving example. The 11th century saw some of Japan's greatest artistic triumphs. Another strain of Buddhism was now proving popular, the so-called Jodo. Central to this was the figure of the Amida Buddha, whose name would be chanted in halls built in his honor. Some of these are among the finest of all Japanese architecture, and the most famous Amida Hall was completed in 1053. It can still be admired at a site midway between Nara and Kyoto. This memorable building was part of the monastery known as the Byodo Inn, the Phoenix Hall. The name derives from the layout of the building. On either side of the central hall are L-shaped wing corridors. To the rear is a tail corridor that gives the whole structure the appearance of a phoenix in flight. To the front of the hall is a small lake, which reflects the architecture and adds to the overall sense of peace and harmony. This is a building that reveals an increasingly distinctive Japanese identity, but its splendor is not restricted to the exterior. Moving inside the hall, we find a golden statue of the Amida Buddha himself, the work of a sculptor named Jorcho, and an artistic triumph in its own right.
The Phoenix Hō, or the Hō Dō, is one of the most distinctive examples of the worship of the Amida Buddha. It depicts the Buddha in the pure land of paradise, and as such is one of the finest examples of the aristocratic Heian period's religious architecture. The name Phoenix Hō comes from two different features. First of all, there are bronze birds that are regarded as being phoenixes attached to the roof of the hall. In addition, the whole design of the layout of the landscape is shaped like a phoenix, and it's symbolized as being separated from the secular world by a large canal that goes around the outside. In that sense, it's symbolic of Buddhist separation from the profane world.
The Phoenix Hall can be seen as a symbol of a confident 11th century nation. At the time it was built, the Fujiwara clan were Japan's rulers, and they would maintain control for another 100 years. But in the early decades of the 12th century, potential rivals began to emerge. The Taira of the southwest and the Minamoto of the east. In 1158, civil war broke out. 2 years later, the Taira defeated the Minamoto and ousted the Fujiwara from power. But the Minamoto were not vanquished. In 1180, their leader, Yoritomo, led an uprising in the east. 5 years of bloody conflict later, he emerged victorious, and another age of Japanese history had begun. With the emperor still in place at Kyoto, Yoritomo set up his headquarters at the coastal town of Kamakura, near present-day Tokyo. In 1192, he was heralded as the barbarian-quelling great general, a title more commonly referred to as shogun. Yoritomo was the first of the shoguns. These shoguns would rule Japan for almost 7 centuries, but for the first half of this period, they presided over a divided nation. Japanese society was highly feudal, with estate-owning barons ruling on their own territory. Inevitably, disputes arose between rival lords, and conflict became a constant feature of Japanese life. A professional class of warriors began to emerge, a body of fighting men forever associated with Japan, the samurai. Originally, the samurai's role was that of a policeman, employed by a lord to protect his land and property. The word itself derived from the verb samuro, meaning to serve. But as Japan became an increasingly military state, the samurai became a warrior class in their own right. Men whose sole business was fighting. They sought to become revered warriors and possessed their own code of honor, the code of Bushido.
Bushido, meaning the way of the warrior, was a system of thought, part religious and part political, that emerged during the medieval period when Japan was riven by civil war, and was developed even further in the 15th to 17th centuries. The basic idea comes from Zen Buddhism. It is the idea that the true warrior, the samurai, should not be concerned by the various petty doings of the world, and that includes a fear of death. Therefore, in its ultimate manifestation, someone who follows Bushido will be happy to go into battle knowing that if he dies, it really doesn't matter.
Bushido, the way of the samurai, developed over a long period of time, but in many ways it was codified into a system during a period of long period of peace during the Tokugawa period, the Edo period, from 1600 to 1868, when there were no major battles, so that the raison d'etre of what a samurai was, both from the practical sense of a military man and also the philosophical sense, and also the civil sense, what was their role in government.
So the Bushido, the cult of the warrior, is largely invented to compensate for a period when there's no longer any real battlefield practice. So a lot of what we hear about the cult of Bushido is advocating modes of practice which simply couldn't be maintained in a real battlefield situation. Any anthropologist, any historian of war will tell you, never in Japan, never anywhere, do people really behave like that. Right? You can persuade soldiers to die in battle for certain periods, but the idea that you train from birth to die in battle is a rather implausible notion. But it's very plausible for a group of people who are living in times of peace who see themselves as people maintaining a martial pedigree.
The samurai displayed courage, endurance, and loyalty in the name of Bushido. But it is for their prowess in battle that they're best remembered today. In appearance, the individual samurai was a formidable sight to behold. His armor contributed strongly to this. Overlapping iron plates were joined with colored cord to create a protective skin. On top of this, further protection was provided by a breastplate, iron gauntlets, leg shields, and neck collar. But this body protection was more than just functional. The overall design was often so intricately detailed that samurai suits of armor are considered works of art in their own right. This is also the case with the samurai's weapons, especially the instrument of battle that the individual warrior treasured most, the samurai sword. A samurai actually carried two swords, with the shorter blade intended for the execution of ritual suicide, or seppuku, if the code of Bushido demanded it. But it is the fearsome samurai battle sword that impresses most today. This was the weapon that was central to the identity of the samurai warrior. His soul was believed to be present within it, and the craftsmen who made these weapons were believed to have supernatural powers. The sword, like the armor, was a creation of genuine beauty, but it was primarily a devastating weapon, and a single stroke of the blade could cut a man in two.
The making of swords in medieval and later Japan was not just considered a type of manufacture, it was actually a type of art. The Japanese were amongst the first peoples in the world to use carbonized steel rather than ordinary iron to make their swords. And that, of course, tempered the steel and made it much harder and finer.
This contrasts with most, for example, Western swords, which are incredibly strong. You can probably hack apart an iron bar with a crusader's sword, but they have no flexibility, and if you hit them in the wrong angle, they may easily shatter. By contrast, you have the Islamic sword, which is very light and can slice through silk, right, has the advantage of being very flexible, which can't cut through armor, for example. The Japanese sword combines these two features in what appears to be a genuinely indigenous piece of technology.
In addition, their techniques of beating down the steel until it made a very fine blade and point were exceptionally developed. And even today, there are many schools of sword making which have their own various masters and methods that are regarded as being the products of apprentices who must learn their trade over many years. Of course, in the more contemporary period, they have not used the technique which was used in the 18th century to test the sword, which was cutting off the heads of executed criminals in an attempt to see how fine the blades actually were.
In the first half of the 13th century, weapons like this were used in combat time and again. There were so many armed disputes between the feudal barons that warfare was effectively a national industry. But before the century was out, Japan faced a threat to its existence as a whole, a threat that would require the samurai to fight together in common cause. This was an enemy from the Asian mainland, the ever-expanding Mongol Empire, under the leadership of Kublai Khan. At the time, the Mongols controlled the greatest land empire the world had ever seen. By the 1260s, their territory stretched from the Pacific to the Balkans. In the east, China and the Korean Peninsula were already under Mongolian control, and the islands of Japan were next in line for conquest. In 1268, Kublai Khan sent a diplomatic message to the Japanese court at Kyoto. He demanded a huge payment of tribute, with dire consequences if it was refused. In Kamakura, the military leadership decided to be bold. They simply offered no response to the Mongol leader. War was now inevitable. In November 1274, an armada of 800 ships left the Asian mainland, carrying some 25,000 warriors, Koreans and Chinese, along with their Mongol commanders. Fortunately for the Japanese, this invasion fleet was forced to withdraw in the face of a typhoon. The defenders had won a respite, but they knew it would be temporary. Kublai Khan was bound to try again, and this second attack duly came in the summer of 1281. Japan now faced a defining moment of its history. This time, the invasion force was stupendous. As many as 150,000 men may have set sail from the mainland, with the Mongols again joined by Korean and Chinese allies. In June, some 3,500 junks appeared off the southwestern coasts of Japan. Over the following 2 months, fierce fighting took place as the invaders sought to establish bridgeheads. In places like the Shiga Peninsula, they succeeded, and the Japanese found themselves pushed back into the interior. But now, the weather intervened once more. On the afternoon of the 15th of August, 1281, a ferocious storm struck the coast of Kyushu. Hundreds of Mongol ships were destroyed as others sought desperately to withdraw from the fray. The troops already ashore were now isolated, and the samurai warriors cut them down without mercy. Only a tiny fraction of the huge invading force ever returned home, and Japan had won a decisive victory. The Mongols would not return. Afterwards, the Japanese people gave the typhoon a name that is now familiar well beyond their shores. They called it the Divine Wind, the Kamikaze.
Kublai Khan, the Mongol leader of China at the time, would have had a very good chance to take over Japan in 1281 if his invasion had succeeded. However, the lucky chance of the storm, which destroyed a large amount of that fleet, meant that the invasion was no longer practical. And that meant also that by the time that Kublai Khan had managed to get his act together again and produce another fleet and another load of soldiers, he simply didn't have enough time and attention to be able to mount the kind of concerted effort that an invasion would have needed. So in effect, the high point that he had in 1281 was lost because of the storm.
The impact of this was something that became a myth in Japan as well. In other words, the defeat of these grand powers that had overcome the entire Asian mainland and all the way to the European other side, the fact that Japan didn't fall under that invading force, then become a myth of Japan to a certain extent of the divine country. There's a sense that there was prophesied that a divine wind would save Japan. This is the word kamikaze, and of course it appears in the modern times as for the suicide pilots at the end of World War II, the sense of the divine wind, that Japan is a divine country, with the emperor descended from the sun goddess and this sense that it's invincible.
The victory of 1281 is still remembered fondly by the Japanese people. It remains a defining moment of their history. Not until the year 1945 would foreign troops again set foot on Japanese soil. But the triumph over the Mongols did not lead to a great age of peace.
Japan had mobilized much of its military forces to go along to the area where, of the coast where attack would come, to build fortifications, to encamp themselves over long periods of time. And when the Mongols were routed, the shogunate had to repay all their warriors for the work they'd done, and they had nothing to repay them with. Previously, a battle meant a defeated enemy whose lands you seized and which you gave to your retainers. And on this occasion, there was nothing to give out. And many people see the ultimate collapse of the first shogunate directly as a result of the inability to reward their vassals for fighting, or not fighting, but for stationing themselves in preparedness against the Mongols.
Resentment built up against the Hojo clan, who now ruled the country. Again, the issue would be settled by war. By 1336, a new shogunate had established itself, the Ashikaga. This was the beginning of an age named after the suburb of Kyoto, where the new military leadership made its headquarters. This was the Muromachi era. In many ways, the age of Muromachi saw Japanese life continue as it had for centuries. The figurehead emperor still sat at the center of the Kyoto court. Local conflicts continued to engage the samurai warriors, and the Buddhist faith remained central to Japanese spiritual life. But this was also a time when a new strain of Buddhism began to emerge, Zen Buddhism. Zen had first arrived from China during the Kamakura era, but it was in the 15th and 16th centuries that it made its most substantial impact in Japan. In the 16th century, the increasing popularity of Zen inspired many activities that are amongst the best-known features of the Japanese way of life. Flower arranging was one of these. Another was the art of landscape gardening. And across the Japanese islands can be seen examples of these tranquil, almost understated gardens. The growth of Zen Buddhism created many cultural changes, most notably with the introduction of the famous tea ceremonies, which reflected the spirituality of the times. Both the ritual of the ceremony and the dedicated buildings used for its purpose remain fascinating to many Western visitors today.
The tea ceremony is a uniquely Japanese phenomenon. It's a combination of religious and social significance. The whole thing, while obviously a social ceremony, is also carried out according to very hierarchical and strict rules. In practice, what happens is that a tea ceremony master, and it does take many years of training, will put together a brazier of coals, and on top of that, brew the special type of tea. To drink the tea, you need specially aged bowls, known as chawan, which are brought out and used ceremonially to drink the first drawing of the tea, known often as thick tea. When this is drunk, often small, dry biscuit types of refreshments are handed out as well to the various guests. And it's important ceremonially for them to compliment the tea, compliment the refreshments, and then talk on a social level.
You would have a discussion of the lineage of the particular pieces, who's owned them in the past, who made them, what's the type of thing it is. And so it's, in a time before museums, it was the setting for having some people over and showing your treasures. The tea itself, which is very powerful because you're drinking powdered tea, and you'd also drink a couple of tea cups of it during the day, and sometimes really thick stuff, so you actually get quite a buzz. And if you're kneeling in relative composure, relative meditative sort of feeling, your concentration, if you do this all the time, raises.
It was also noticed that it keeps you awake, and so it was drunk in temples to assist monks who have to go through long periods of rather tedious recitations or meditational practices, often throughout the night. Tea drinking was good for that.
By the middle of the 16th century, the spirit of Zen Buddhism had established itself in Japanese everyday life. The surviving tea ceremony buildings and landscape gardens show its influence. But Japan was about to be introduced to a totally new approach to the business of living, and to the business of faith in particular. Europe was about to make its mark on Japanese history. In 1542, a sailing ship was wrecked on the coast of Kyushu. It was a Chinese junk, but amongst those who scrambled ashore were three mariners from a nation on the other side of the world, Portugal. This was the very beginning of contact between Europe and Japan. and first impressions were mutually favourable. The Portuguese sailors admired what appeared to be an extremely advanced Japanese civilization. For their part, the Japanese were interested in the muskets and firearms carried by the Europeans. It soon became clear that the two cultures could do business with each other. During the years that followed, the Portuguese returned to Japan in increasing numbers. This was the European Age of Discovery, and soon Spanish and Dutch expeditions also arrived at this mysterious East Asian nation. Commerce drew them to Japan, but as well as European goods, the trading ships also brought something else that soon enthused many in the land of the rising sun: Christianity. In 1549, a Portuguese ship arrived at the port of Kagoshima. On board was a legendary figure of the Christian faith, Francis Xavier, later to become Saint Francis. This Jesuit missionary had already spread the gospel through India and Southeast Asia. Now he began to preach to the people of Japan with remarkable results. Within 2 years, he had established a flourishing Japanese community devoted to an entirely new faith. Other missionaries followed Xavier's example, and by the end of the 16th century, some 300,000 Japanese people had accepted the word of Christ.
The late 16th century was a period of relative instability, the period from the end of the 15th century till about the 1570s was generally called the period of warring states, when you had the daimyo, the lords, competing, the big powerful figures around the country, great warlords vying to take over and become the most powerful and therefore rule Japan.
Many of the warlords in Japan found that by converting to Christianity, they thought that perhaps they would get the Portuguese and the Spanish, who were behind the Jesuits, on their side against the current rulers of Japan. In addition, the Christian philosophy was attractive to many of the Japanese who picked it up for the first time. Of course, Christianity was not regarded as necessarily being exclusively different from the existing Japanese religions, just as Buddhism had come in many centuries before and adapted to the Japanese way of life. Many Japanese Christians thought that Christianity could also be brought in and made part of the Japanese religious systems. And to some extent, they were surprised when the Jesuits explained that if they wished to be Christians, they would have to give up their other religions as well. But nonetheless, several hundreds of thousands of Japanese did in fact find that this was an attractive and powerful new way of thinking about religion.
In the early years of the 17th century, the Japanese Christian community continued to expand. By 1615, it was 500,000 strong. But times were changing. A new shogunate had been established in 1603. The Tokugawa, based at Edo, the city now known as Tokyo. The new military leader was Tokugawa Ieyasu, a giant figure of Japanese history. A man who suspected that the Christian invasion of Japan would lead to European political domination of his people. In 1614, Christianity was officially banned. A quarter of a century of persecution and martyrdom followed, until in 1638, the 37,000 Christians who remained found themselves besieged near the port of Nagasaki. When the siege was broken, virtually all were slaughtered. The Christian faith had survived less than 100 years.
The Tokugawa shogunate were not worried about Christianity for religious reasons. They were worried about it for political reasons. They felt that if this new foreign method of thought was allowed to spread in Japan, it could open the way for an invasion by the Portuguese, the Spanish, or some other Christian nation. In addition, they realized that many local warlords were using Christianity as a means to try and oppose the Buddhist clergy, who had powerful official positions in Japan at the time. Furthermore, they felt that Christianity's emphasis on the individual was destroying the collective identity which they wished the Japanese people to hold, so that they would stick to their proper places in society and not attempt to rock the political boat. Therefore, when they did start to persecute Christians, it was because they feared that their power base might be destroyed, not because they were worried about the theological implications of Christianity.
The 1638 slaughter of the Christians was a major historical event. It marked the beginning of 2 centuries in which Japan was completely isolated from the outside world. Trading ships were all but banned, and travelling abroad was made virtually impossible for the Japanese citizen. In addition, the Tokugawa consolidated their power still further. The Japanese state now became centralized and unified. This was a very different kind of political situation. Instead of almost continuous warfare between individual feudal territories, Japan now enjoyed a long period of peace. The Tokugawa shoguns devised a cunning way to maintain the status quo. All feudal lords were required to spend every other year at Edo, where the shogunate could keep an eye on them. In the intervening years, they were forced to send their wives as hostages. The system worked, and the Tokugawa endured until the industrial age. Though Japan was now isolated, the country did not stagnate. The years from 1603 until 1867 saw substantial advances in Japanese social and cultural life. And one of the most remarkable of all Japanese architectural achievements dates from early in the Tokugawa period. In the 14th century, the practice of castle building had become established as warfare continued to rage throughout the country. One such castle was constructed at Himeji, 25 miles to the west of Osaka. But in the late 16th century, the arrival of firearms meant that a more formidable defensive structure was required. In 1601, the Lord of Himeji ordered the construction of brand new fortifications. 9 years of enormous effort later, the work was completed. And the result was one of the greatest monuments in the whole of Japan, Himeji Castle. The castle consists of a main tower and 3 subsidiary towers. The main tower is built on an impressive platform of rock, which also contains the 2 basement floors of the 7-story structure. The building is again mainly constructed from wood, but this did not compromise the defense of Himeji Castle or make it less fortified than stone-built European equivalents. The entire construction is protected by a moat, walls of stone, and a bewildering number of turrets, hiding places, tunnels, watchtowers, and no less than 84 castle gates. It was and remains a powerful defensive structure. But Himeji Castle can also be admired for its graceful appearance. Its architect brought the same degree of natural elegance to this military building as his predecessors achieved with their religious constructions.
The Himeji Castle is also known in Japanese as Shirasagi, which means the egret castle. And that's because its tall white turrets to many Japanese look similar to the elegant white plumage of the egret. The castle is unique because it combines a huge number of turrets which combine a defensive purpose with aesthetic beauty. It's an extraordinary range of different sections of different types of architectural parts of a castle stuck together to make one massive, almost wedding cake-like confection.
It's an amazing range of outworks. You could hardly find your way around the castle. Even if you view it from the air or from a plan, it's hard to work out how you would get in and how you'd move around. You're always coming against false avenues, false alleys. You run down what looks like an important path that ends in nothing, or it suddenly narrows. There are gates between which people could be trapped. There are places where you can throw stones or drop boiling oil into anyone coming in. And the castle was successful enough that, in fact, it never was stormed.
It's the second biggest castle in Japan, exceeded only by the major castle in Osaka. and it has over 50 turrets, most of which are considered items of great artistic beauty.
In the 400 years that Himeji Castle has stood, its military significance has been secondary to its beauty. Its completion coincided with the end of internal Japanese warfare. In the centuries that followed, the Tokugawa presided over a nation at peace, and wonderful buildings such as this were used as grand residences. This new age of peace meant less of a role for the famous samurai. With no wars to fight, many drifted into the expanding cities, such as Edo. By the 18th century, the urban center that is now Tokyo was the biggest city in the world, and many former samurai found themselves living there. Some were able to flourish in new roles, such as the civil service or teaching. Others disappeared into the twilight world of the yukio, or floating world of urban nightlife. In 18th century Edo, this yukio was an indulgent world where many succumbed to the temptations of strong drink. Others sought out the comforts of the geisha girls, who became established around this time. Many contemporary Japanese artists chose this world of the night as the subject matter for their distinctive woodblock paintings. This was the so-called ukiyo-e style of painting, which reached its peak around 1800 with the work of Kitagawa Utimaro.
The ukiyo-e woodblock paintings give us an insight into the non-official part of Japanese life during the Edo period of the 16th to the 19th centuries. Although they're not realistic in the sense of trying to literally put down with paint and woodblocks images from the streets, they give us little insights into the way in which ordinary townspeople lived. For instance, a bunch of commuters, one might call them, in little hats trying to get away from a bridge during a rain shower, or actors in the kabuki theater taking a rest between the various acts. To that extent, they reflect the ukiyo, the unofficial world of the artists and the pleasure quarters of cities like Edo, now known as Tokyo, where people went for entertainment and to unwind after a hard day's work.
The distinctive style of Japanese art would come to influence many artists in the Western world. But this would not be until after Japan had finally ended its long period of isolation. In the 1860s, following pressure from the industrialized powers of the West, Japan finally opened itself up to the outside world once more. The shogunate came to an end, and the emperor regained political power after some 11 centuries. Japan now pursued the path of industrialization with astonishing speed. Within decades, the Japanese had adopted industrial methods so effectively that they were able to defeat the might of the Russian Navy. By the time of the Second World War, the Japanese nation had become mightier still. Only the American atomic bomb brought a final end to an empire that had conquered an enormous region of Asia and the Pacific. And though the Japanese were defeated, their national identity survived. The Japanese civilization remains one of the most remarkable on Earth.